الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا مباركا فيه. الحمد لله فيما جرت به المقادير، إن كل شيء خلقناه بقدر، وما أمرنا إلا واحدة كلمح بالبصر، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده بلا شريك، وحده بلا شبيه، وحده بلا مثيل، ووحده بلا وليد. وقل الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل، وكبره تكبيرا. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا والحريص علينا والرؤوف بنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله، من أطاع الرسول فقد أطاع الله، وما أرسلناك عليهم حفيظا. من يطع الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا مضل له، ومن يعص الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا هادي له. اللهم اجعلنا من الذين يستمعون قولك فيتبعون أحسنه. أما بعد، committed brothers and committed sisters، to take the previous khutbas a step forward and to surround this mentality of degrading or debasing all the way to kufr the other Muslim, this is not a character and it's not a manner of those who understand Allah and His Prophet correctly. So on our way to Allah Jalla wa Ala, we shall shed light on these characters who verbally denounce other Muslims as a first step in eliminating other Muslims. All of us are readers of Allah's book, the faultless Quran, and there are too many ayat in the Quran more than we can quote here in this khutbah, even though we will quote some of them. By necessity, it's not my way of delivering a khutbah to quote at length the ayat in the Quran, but in this case it is necessary to do so to relate to you, the listeners, how the positive and optimistic attitude in the Quran is towards الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. An ayah number 9 in Surah Al-Isra says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمْ وَيُبَشِّرُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا. Indeed, this Quran, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمْ, guides to what is most appropriate. وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا. And it breaks good news to the committed Muslims that they shall have a tremendous reward, a voluminous reward. Ayah number 2 in Surah Al-Kahf, وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا حَسَنًا. And it breaks good news to the committed Muslims who do الصالحات that they shall have أَجْرًا حَسَنًا, a regard or a reward of perfection, a perfected reward. Ayah number 25, Surah Al-Baqarah, وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ كُلَّمَا رُزِقُوا مِنْهَا مِنْ ثَمَرَةٍ رِزْقًا قَالُوا هَذَا الَّذِي رُزِقُنَا مِنْ قَبْلٍ وَأُتُوا بِهِ مُتَشَابِهًا وَلَهُمْ فِيهَا أَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَّرَةٌ وَهُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Another ayah that says, and break good news to those who are committed to Allah's power and authority and do His good will. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ, to them they shall have a paradise or gardens under which rivers flow, to the end of the ayah. وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنَّ لَهُمْ قَدَمَ صِدْقٍ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. Ayah number 20 in Surah, or ayah number 2 in Surah Yunus. And give glad tidings or break good news to the committed Muslims, those who commit themselves to Allah, that they will have a foothold of truth with their sustainer. Ayat 10 through 13 in Surah As-Saff. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى تِجَارَةٍ تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ يدخلكم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ومساكن طيبة في جنات عدن ذلك الفوز العظيم وأخرى تحبونها نصر من الله وفتح قريب وبشر المؤمنين. Brothers, I don't have the time to simply translate this ayah, but at the end of it says وبشر المؤمنين, and express good news to the committed Muslims. And I'm sure you're familiar with these ayats, so I don't have to really translate every one. It's enough to say another ayah 30 through 32 in Surah Fussilat. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون نزلا من غفور رحيم. These ayat, and as I said, there's plenty others in the Quran that run this general course. All of them, of course, have their details to them. They have their context and all of this. Without getting involved in all of this, when you read these ayat, scores of them throughout the Quran, you get the impression, the unmistakable impression of expecting what is good from Allah. As long as you say, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله, and you spend your life, your behavioral life, your effortful life, your labor intensive life in doing what you say, in translating your commitment, your iman to amalin salih, but then there comes a hadith, and you know from the many khutbas you've listened to from yours faithfully, that we don't dwell on a particular hadith. We dwell on the ayat of the Quran, and in that context we mention some hadiths. But in this case, we are going to dwell on one particular hadith, because this hadith, not the ayat, they were these types of people, these mukaffireen, or takfiriyin, whatever you want to call them, that accuse other Muslims of being kafirs. This is one of the hadiths that they justify for their behavior. It's called Hadith Iftiraq al-Ummah. The hadith pertaining to the disbandment or the dispersion or the breakup of the Ummah. A hadith that has what they quote as being al-firqa al-najiyah, the saved faction, or the redeemed faction. The first general observation for anyone who wants to spend the time to go through the books of hadiths about this, to find this particular hadith, he will find that this hadith is quoted with different words and even contradictory words. The most popular quotation of this hadith, افترقت اليهود على 71 فرقة والنصارى على 72 فرقة وستفترق هذه الأمة على 73 فرقة. What is this saying? Hadith, they say these people who scramble around this hadith, they say that the Prophet said that the Yahud were divided into 71 factions, and the Christians or Nasara were divided into 72 factions, and this Ummah will be divided into 73 factions. Now, to trace the irreconcilabilities of the many quotes of this hadith in the books of hadith. For those Muslims who refer to as-sihah as-sith, the six books of authentic or indisputable hadiths. This hadith was only mentioned in Sahih at-Tirmidhi. Wasn't mentioned in the rest of the books of hadith. One form of this hadith ends saying كلها في النار إلا فرقة, meaning all of them, all of these factions, the 73, all of them are in the fire except one. Another rendition of this hadith says كلها في النار إلا واحدة وهي الجماعة. All of them are in the fire except one, and this one is al-jama'a. Here, when we listen to this word, those of us who have a sense of Islamic history will begin to detect that this word al-jama'a, which came into circulation during the Umayyad reign, has some type of Umayyad influence in it. For those of you who are not aware, the coining of the word Ahl, As-Sunnah, Wal-Jama'ah is not a Quranic phrase, it is not a prophetic phrase. This phrase was put together when Muawiyah finally consolidated his power after the assassination of Al-Imam Ali. This is the time when the wording Ahl, As-Sunnah, Wal-Jama'ah came into vogue. Yet another formulation of this same hadith, all of it begins, افترقت اليهود, then افترقت النصارى, then تفترق هذه الأمة, and these are the way they are ending. The third way it ends is كلهم في النار إلا واحدة وهي ما أنا عليه وأصحابي. All of them. Now imagine when I'm saying this to you, dear brothers and sisters, committed Muslims. When you hear this, remember these people who are amplifying this hadith nowadays. They are saying that the Prophet is saying this. When you listen to this, as if the Prophet, number one, is forecasting the failure of his ummah more than the failure of al-Yahud and the Nasara. I don't think reading, having a Quranic mind and understanding Allah's Prophet in his substantiated hadith is going to be glooming and dooming about his own ummah. Nevertheless, the connotations and the meanings of these quotes that I'm bringing you deliver that sense. All of them are in the fire. He's saying all of my ummah is in the fire except one, and that one represents what I am in addition to my companions, ashabi. Here is another indicator for those of you who have gone through Islamic literature. There's two types of Muslims that go on alert. When the word ashabi is used, the Shi'i Muslims go on alert. When the word al-Muhammad or Ahl al-Bayt is used in a particular hadith, the Sunnis go on alert. There's no reason for anyone to go on alert. The only thing here is you try to place whatever that hadith is in the context of the Quran. If it fits in that context, you begin to think through it. If it doesn't fit into that context, Don't sweat the small things. Another ending of the same hadith. You see how many endings this beginning of the hadith has? The other one says, كلها في النار إلا السواد الأعظم. All of them are in the fire except for the overwhelming majority. Now this would mean, if you're thinking about the hadith, this would mean that the 72, because there's one that is redeemed, Al-Firqa Najiyah, but there's 72 of them that are condemned to the fire. Now, the description in this particular ending said, إِلَّا السَّوَادِ الْأَعْظَمِ, which means the majority, the overwhelming majority of the ummah is saved. If you apply this to the ones who are speaking today about this particular hadith to justify the description of kufr upon other Muslims, you'll see today that this hadith contradicts them because they are not in the overwhelming majority of Muslims. Nevertheless, they state it because they know when they state these hadiths, Muslims out there are not thinking. They can state a hadith like this that ends, كُلُّهَا فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا السَّوَادَ الْأَعْظَمِ, not knowing they are contradicting themselves. I'm skipping some here. There's a lot to this ending of this same hadith. It begins the same way, but it ends in different sentences. One of them says, كلهم في النار وواحدة في الجنة. قال الجماعات الجماعات. All of them are in the fire except one. And what is this one? He says, الجماعات. He's describing it. الجماعات الجماعات. Question mark. Then it says, another hadith. The same hadith, but another ending. كلهم في النار إلا ملة واحدة. All of them are in the fire except one milla. When the word milla is used, it brings to mind our ignorance. Who, brothers and sisters, listen carefully. The word ummah is a Quranic word. The word milla is a Quranic word. The word ta'ifa is a Quranic word. The word firqa is a Quranic word. The word nihla is used. But who? You've heard these words before. I'm sure you've heard them many times. But can you tell us, scanning the vocabulary of the Quran, the ayat and the verified ahadith, what's the difference between an ummah and a millah? What's the difference between a ta'ifa and a firqa? I venture to say that, with all due respect to the contemporary ulama, and with all due respect to the ulama of the past, we don't have a functional and an operational distinctive definition of these words, which goes to say to us, we haven't thought through the wording of the ayat and the wording of the ahadith. And then, if the other ahadith are saying firqa, كلها في النار إلا firqa, here this hadith saying كلها في النار إلا ملة. Has anyone thought, especially these people, these takfiris, who are right now, they have the microphones and they have the bank accounts, and they also have the weapons, and they told us
Have they themselves given these ahadith a second thought and explained what they mean? No. They're just using them to justify their hostility and their warfare against those that they consider outside of their definition of who is al-firqa and najiya. Another one ends with, and I'm skipping some, I have to. The other one ends, كُلُّهَا ضَلَالَ إِلَّا فِرْقَةِ الْإِسْلَامِ وَجَمَاعَتَهُمْ. All of them, the 72 factions of Islam that they tell us are doomed in the fire, all of them, كُلُّهَا ضَلَالَ. Islam, all of this has become ضَلَالَ. إِلَّا فِرْقَةَ الْإِسْلَامِ, except the firqa of Islam. Well, all the rest say that they are the firqa of Islam. وَجَمَاعَتَهُمْ. Now once again, you find here there is a political hand in the hadith. If you can go back to the time frame of the writing of this hadith, the political time frame and what was happening as far as Umayyad and Abbasi control of the Muslims. Now, here's the kicker, so to speak. Here's the kicker. One of these hadiths ends this way. Kulluha fil, you know, the same hadith that we quoted at the beginning. افترقت اليهود على 71 فرقة وافترقت النصارى على 72 فرقة وتفترق هذه الأمة على 73 فرقة. And this is the way this particular hadith ends. كلها في الجنة إلا واحدة. What happened? We ran across all these other ahadith saying كلها في النار إلا واحدة. This particular one says كلها في الجنة إلا واحدة. Isn't this contradictory? Some people here who took it upon themselves to say the Prophet said this hadith are contradicting themselves. The body of a hadith is a polluted body. I'm sorry to say this. And it hasn't been filtered yet. None. There hasn't been a coordinated, serious, honest Islamic effort to filter these hundreds of thousands of ahadith that we have. We here are just zeroing in on one particular hadith and coming up with these inconsistencies. The rawi of this hadith, the rawis of this hadith are the following: Abu Huraira, Anas ibn Malik, Abdullah ibn Amr, Jabir ibn Abdullah, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Auf ibn Malik, Amr ibn Auf, Abu Darda, Wafila ibn al-Asqa, and Abu Umama al-Bahili. These are the people who we are told. You see, in the books of hadith, when a person who, whether he is al-Bukhari or whether he is Muslim or whoever he is, when they want to bring us a hadith, write down for us that the Prophet said a certain statement, they need narrators. So the original narrators, we are told by these writers of the hadith, by the way, Bukhari and Muslim and Nasa'i and Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah, they did not quote this hadith. It's only a Tirmidhi who quoted this hadith. And let me mention before I forget, only certain editions of At-Tirmidhi mention this hadith. You can go to a certain edition of another Tirmidhi, Sahih At-Tirmidhi, you can go to an edition and you'll not find the hadith in it. So when we say only At-Tirmidhi mentioned the hadith, it's only in some published editions, which would have you think what? Is someone playing around with the publications of these books of hadith? It's obvious in this case. It's also been narrated as a hadith mawquf and a hadith mursal. Now you're going to ask, what's the difference between a hadith that is mawquf and a hadith that is mursal? A hadith that is mawquf is one that goes all the way to the Sahabi, but doesn't go to the Prophet. The Sahabi said, and then he quotes the hadith. But he doesn't say the Prophet said. Al-Mursal is yet a weaker type of hadith that is quoted by a Tabi'i. It's not even quoted by a Sahabi or the Prophet. And this hadith falls into these two other categories. And then, I don't have the time, I have the information. I simply don't have the time. I will summarize to tell you all of these, the sequential narrative. So-and-so said that, so-and-so said, all the way back to the Prophet, pertaining to this one particular hadith that is used to justify the kufr of other Muslims. This particular hadith, all who narrated it had either a person who is untrustworthy in that sequence, or a person who is not reliable, or a person who can only be quoted when others have already quoted the hadith. When we put all of this together, we realize that this hadith is flawed. It should not be used or quoted by Muslims as a reliable hadith. The scholars of old, not the contemporary scholars are not showing us much courage when it comes to the body of hadith. Even though, and I want to tell you this is on good and reliable authority, that some scholars in Egypt, about 20 or 25 years ago, they had, and these are the highest ranking scholars of that land, they had a get together. And they said to themselves, I don't think I've mentioned it, I may have mentioned it to some of you, but I haven't mentioned this in the khutbah. They come and said to themselves, after discussing certain matters, we have a problem in the literature of hadith. Remember, they dare not say this in public. We have an issue with the body of hadith that we have. And our primary problem is concentrated in the riwayat of Abu Huraira. And no one disagreed among themselves. They recognized a problem that has to be worked on. Okay? Someone recognizes a problem. No one said Abu Huraira is ma'soom or Abu Huraira is, you know, a person who doesn't make mistakes in these times. Okay, we have a problem. Okay, let's try to fix the problem. So they reach this point. We have to fix a problem. But then, they know very well the weight of traditions and the weight of history and culture. So they said, who qualifies from among us, who qualifies to begin a task of scrutinizing the hadiths of Abu Hurairah, meaning some of them are sahih and valid hadiths and others are not, because it's sort of taken as granted from the build up of these traditions and the ritualistics that have gone down from generation to generation. Someone's going to take on Abu Hurairah, he's probably going to run into this brick wall of traditions, he's going to discredit himself, and nothing is going to happen. So with this in their internal thoughts, they looked at each other and said, they nominated one of them, may Allah bless his soul, he has passed away, maybe about, I don't know, 18 years ago or so. He passed away. They said, you are the only one who is able to do this. He looked at them, he said, but I'm sorry, I have to apologize. I'm somewhat in my latter years in life, and this is too much of a task for me alone. And this hadith is also, no, this hadith, تَفْتَرِقُوا اِفْتَرَقَتِ الْيَهُودِ عَلَىٰ 71 فِرْقَةً وافترقت النصارى على 72 فرقة وتفترق هذه الأمة على 73 فرقة. And then we quoted for you the many last sentences of this same hadith. Some of them irreconcilable and some of them contradictory and some of them don't make sense. So this hadith is known as a hadith ahad. It is not a hadith mutawatir. And a hadith ahad, I'm saying this for those who are in this technical area. It's alright if I part company from some of you here, I'm available to you after the khutbah. But for some of these who are in the technical area of hadith, the hadith ahad is not, and this is by consensus, by the people who narrated the hadith and those who worked their life in the area of hadith. The hadith ahad are not relied upon in what are called aqadi issues, in matters pertaining to belief. That means if you accept it or if you don't accept it, it's not going to harm the feature of iman in you. The ahadith of ahad are considered in what are known as practical matters, not ideological or theoretical or theological matters. The hadith ahad here, whether you accept it or don't accept it, it doesn't add or doesn't subtract from your imani character. And then this hadith on another, in two other aspects of it. One aspect is the aspect of ummah. Please, brothers and sisters, when you come across the word ummah, when this word, this is a Quranic word. In the Quran, when ummah is attached to the noun that refers to you, the committed Muslims, it is a positive word. وَأَنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. This is your ummah, one ummah. See, there's a positive connotation to the word ummah. When the Prophet uses the word ummah and relates it to himself, it comes also in a favorable relationship. When he says, as a shafa'ah, when he is to present his words of pleading with Allah for his ummah, he says, ummati, ummati, my ummah, my ummah. But when ummah is used just by just the word ummah, it doesn't necessarily mean or deliver a positive meaning. So, in this hadith, we have a contradiction between this, the way the word ummah is used in this hadith, وَتَفْتَرِقُ أُمَّتِي. This is a negative this is a negative reference or inference for the word ummah. In the Quran and in the other hadith, when this occurs, there's a positive inference and reference of the word ummah. So please, whenever you know this word ummah is bounced around in certain hadiths or in certain quotations, take in mind the way it is used in the Quran, because that's the reference point. And then the other one is, this hadith brings up what has been, and it will continue to be, this is not a place to solve this issue, I just want to bring it to your attention. It brings up what is called a controversial issue. And that is, does the Prophet know the details of al-ghayb? We can quote ayat in which we are told in these ayat that Allah discloses al-ghayb to some of those He sent who He is satisfied with. لا يطلع على غيبه أحدا إلا من ارتضى من رسول. He doesn't disclose his ghayb to anyone except those who He is satisfied with, in this context, of messengers. لا يعلم, another ayah, لا يعلم الغيب إلا الله. No one knows الغيب except Allah. However way you fall on this, in this, and there are other ayat, and wherever you fall in this, the question here is, when we're talking about this particular hadith, did the Prophet of Allah, if he knew in his heart and in his mind that in the centuries to come, or in the generations to come, his followers are going to be divided, did he know exactly the number of these divisions and these factions? This is a very critical issue. And then what describes a faction? What is it? What makes a faction among the Muslims? This firqa that is used, the word firqa, which roughly translates into faction. What makes a particular group of Muslims a faction? No one has ever told us. Al-Ash'ari, for some of you who are familiar with Islamic history, Al-Ash'ari, he counted more than 100 factions. Where does this place this hadith? Someone say Al-Ash'ari was lying? Or does it somehow bring a question mark to your mind? Another historian, Shahristani, he counted 76. Ibn Hazm counted 5. Of the, I don't know if I mentioned this, of the scholars of old who discredit this hadith altogether, Ibn Hazm was one of them. Ibn al-Wazir, the Yemeni scholar, was another one. Of course, they did their research. They went into this in depth. And at the end, they said, this hadith is groundless, is baseless. It's the same hadith that right now is coming alive in the context of these civil wars, when there are certain big interests in this world that want to see Muslims kill themselves. This is one of these hadiths that is used in that context. اللهم اجعلنا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه ومن أحسن من الله حديثا ومن أصدق من الله قيلا أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ادعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة وتوبوا إلى الله إن الله تواب رحيم. Thank you.
الحمد لله الذي هدى صلى الله وسلم على سيدنا المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه أولي النهى والتقى. Dear brothers, dear sisters, dear committed Muslims, the world that we are in is not a world that recognizes our equality. The policies and the politics that are enforced today mean to pit us against each other. Unfortunately, because there are gaps in our Islamic knowledge, these people who are very busy seeing to it that we are fragmented to the optimum extent. These people, they have studied who we are. If we don't think about our own selves, and many of us don't. This is one of the examples just cited for you in the first khutbah. We haven't given a thought. Anyone come and scrutinize one of these statements that makes a particular group of Muslims feel that they are above everyone else. Now, this hadith that was quoted in the khutbah about the 73 factions that were projected by Allah's Prophet to become the fate of his ummah, except for one. When someone quotes something like that, it gives them the sense of superiority. They become biased. And then they become self-righteous. They are the only ones. What happened? رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. The ayah describes Allah's Prophet as a mercy unto the peoples and the domains of the world. When you ferment this hadith in your mind, you begin to think there's a self-righteous distance between whatever that definition of the redeemed faction is, and the rest. There's not a compatibility between the way these takfiris understand it today and the general ayah that sweeps it aside. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم. Anyone heard that? رحماء بينهم. Let's concede for just a second that, okay, 73 divisions, 73 factions are who we are in the world. And then what do? Turn around and begin to cut down all the rest of the factions? You kill them? What happened to رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ? What happened? The ayah flies away from the mind to accommodate a dubious statement like this? كُلُّهُمْ فِي النَّارِ. The Prophet of Allah is predicting all of his ummah is in the fire. But it takes thought. And these types of masajid that are financed all around the world, they don't want you to think. Don't think. That's the message that goes out from these khutbahs every Jumu'ah. And when we have Muslims who don't think, we have Muslims who can be led very easily to their slaughterhouse by other Muslims.
unfolding in front of our own eyes. There are a lot of these slaughterhouses in different countries. Can you see them? But try to understand where the source of this problem emanates from. Where is the source? And you will inevitably be led to these self-righteous, holier-than-thou religious functionaries, financed and supported by the Saudi regime. And if I'm incorrect on this, anyone can correct me on it. I'm accessible. We are here in the street. But as time goes by and as we have raised the alarm before, they continue, these Saudis continue to get away with murder and mayhem because of the religiously supervised and the religiously instigated ignorance. Every Jumu'ah, every Eid, every lecture, every conference that they sponsor or that they finance. And to us, we have Allah. We have no one and nothing else. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah. وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه ولا تجعله ملتبسا علينا واجعلنا للمتقين إماما ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم اللهم بارك على محمد وآل محمد اللهم بارك على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر.